You have no equals now and forever. Father God, your name is power. Your name is wonderful. Your name is mighty. Lord, we thank you so much that you are the King of Kings, that you are the ruler of our hearts. Lord, help that dwell in us today as we listen to your word. And we thank you. Amen.
Well, I have to say that last week's service was very special as well. It was just, I don't know, there's just something very profound about celebrating the resurrection with you guys, with the church together. It certainly beats the heck out of celebrating it alone. But if you've missed some of the services lately, or I don't know, it's been spotty or whatever, you just haven't been around, I want to take an opportunity to bring you up to speed today. So a few weeks ago, we finished part two of our series in Genesis, and it was called A Creation Worth Believing, and it was all about the creation account of the Bible, and it was apologetics and the biblical and scientific evidence that supports what the Bible says happened at the very beginning. Then after that, we went ahead and moved into, kind of took a little break and celebrated the cross on Palm Sunday, and then we celebrated Easter on Resurrection Sunday, we celebrated the resurrection on Easter Sunday. I guess it could be interchangeable. But we did that just last week. And today I'm excited to get back into our series in Genesis with part three as we focus in on God's original design for mankind. And actually this morning I want to start by jumping right back into the text, and then we'll dive into what it means and how we can apply it. Now if you remember part two, we actually stopped at verse 26 of chapter one. We didn't actually go through the whole thing of the end of it, so that's exactly where we're going to pick up things today. So we'll be going from verse 26 of chapter 1 all the way to verse 15 of chapter 2. So if you got your Bibles this morning, this is going to be really, really hard to find, but I'm going to need to ask you to go ahead and flip through those pages until you get to Genesis chapter 1. Or if you want to look it up on screen, you can save those thumbs a workout. Either way, starting with verse 26, Moses writes, and I forgot to turn there myself. Verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock, the whole earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth. So God created man in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them male and female. God blessed them, and God said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and every creature that crawls on the earth. God also said, look, I have given you every seed-bearing plant on the surface of the entire earth, and every tree whose fruit contains seed. This will be food for you, for all the wildlife of the earth, for every bird of the sky, and for every creature that crawls on the earth, everything having the breath of life in it, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good indeed. Evening came, and then morning, the sixth day. Chapter 2. So the heavens and the earth and everything in them were completed. On the seventh day, God had completed his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. God blessed the seventh day and declared it holy, for on it he rested from all his work of creation. These are the records of the heavens and the earth concerning their creation. At the time that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, no shrub of the field had yet grown on the land, and no plant of the field had yet sprouted, for the Lord God had not made it rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. But mist would come up from the earth and water all the ground. Then the Lord God formed the man out of the dust from the ground and breathed the breath of life into his nostrils. The man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he placed the man he had formed. The Lord God caused to grow out of the ground every tree pleasing in appearance and good for food, including the tree of life in the middle of the garden, as well as the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. A river went out from Eden to water the garden. From there it divided and became the source of four rivers. The name of the first is Pishon, which flows through the entire land of Havilah, where there is gold. Gold from the land is pure. Bdellium and onyx are also there. The name of the second river is Gihon, which flows through the entire land of Cush. The name of the third river is Tigris, which runs east of Assyria, and the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to work it and watch over it. So this is one of my favorite parts of Scripture because of how much depth it contains. I mean, there is so much in here today, and I'll just go ahead and take a moment to say I'm not going to touch all of it today. We're going to have a focus. There's all kinds of things, including the Trinity's in there. Let us make God in our own image. But I want to start today by asking a question. You ever wonder what things were like before the fall? I mean, if sin had never entered the picture, what would our purpose in relationship with God and the world really look like? This morning, something happened that defies telling. It was this morning, I was parked at Tractor Supply. I was in those parking spots that face kind of the nature, the woods, and I was reading my Bible. And in that spot, there's this little clearing right in front of that line of trees where there's some grass, and you can kind of see what's going on. There's some blackberry bushes, a couple shrubs, and that's where I was. That's what I was sitting there looking at. And as I was reading my Bible, in my peripheral vision, I caught some movement and looked up, and there was this beautiful, like, super healthy coyote looking back at me. And I'm like, of all places, a Tractor Supply. But anyway, I thought that was it. And I was like praising God. I'm like, thanks for letting me see that today. But then I saw the coyote kind of get low and crawl into the blackberry bushes. And I was like, ooh, he's on the hunt. He's trying to get something. So I'm like watching this thing for like, 20 minutes, and just trying to keep my eye on where he's going. And then pretty soon out of the corner of my eye on the other side of this clearing, I see a very large bunny rabbit. Mm-hmm. Yes. And I look back at the coyote, and sure enough, he turns up his snout into the wind, catching the scent, and starts walking in the direction of the rabbit. It was real. I felt like I was like watching some kind of nature. David Attenborough needed to be there or something, narrating this. But I watched him, and he got closer and closer. I could see both of them, but they couldn't see each other. And all of a sudden, he got close enough, and the coyote just leapt up like in this acrobatic way and just pounced on this thing. And I'll just say, for those of you who, it's hard for you to stomach this kind of thing. Okay, this rabbit was ugly, all right? He was hard to look at. He was like a walking rotisserie. His time had come, all right? Don't worry about it. I mean, it was kind of sad because it ended in death, which entered the world after the fall. But at the same time, it really was cool because I got to see these detailed and complex creatures really work in their element. It's interesting because I look at creation sometimes and marvel at the fact that even though the Bible says that the earth groans from the curse of sin, and even though so much has been corrupted and tainted, thousands of years later, the beauty that's around us still tells a story of brighter days. Days without death, days without sinners and saints, days when knowing God and living in harmony with Him was actually the norm for human beings. To be honest, though, the beauty of the earth before the curse is something that's pretty easy to talk about when we're thinking about something like, Mount Hood, or how everything bursts with color and life in the springtime. But my question is, what about us? Is there something inside all of us that still points to the beauty that God created before the fall? Well, I would say there is. Have you seen the way that parents love their newborn baby? Have you observed the way a son looks up to his father? Or have you felt the way that true friends bond, or the way a man can love a woman? You see, there is something inside all of us, whether you know the Lord or not, that points back to who He is. Think about it. There's a reason that we have this capacity for love and spiritual contemplation that animals will never understand. And there's a reason why people innately just understand and know that the murder of innocent people is just wrong. The reason is that we've been made in the image of God. Male or female, saved or unsaved, we have been made in the image of God. And that's what makes us unique. But the question is, what does that mean, right? If you look back at verse 17 and notice the phrase, according to our likeness, that does help us understand a little bit more. But even then, what kind of likeness are we talking about? Is it that humans have been made to literally look like God? No, I don't think so. John 4:24 says that God is spirit, and if this were about physical appearances, God would have had to have a body. So the image of God isn't about something we can see with our eyes, which must mean we were made to reflect the spirit of God, which refers to God's thoughts, feelings, and even core values. And that in no way means that we are exact replicas of the Lord of the universe, but what it does mean is that there are parts of who we are that reflect back to parts of who He is. And frankly, that's unbelievably profound, because what it means is that we were originally created to show the entire world who God is by how we live. The best way I can think to explain this would be to think of the relationship, popcorn. Okay, I'm going to be talking about hunting later, but not now. So, but the best way to describe this is to think about the relationship between a child and a parent. If you're a parent, then I'm willing to bet that at least one of your kids thinks exactly like you do. And sometimes this gets us into trouble. But, I mean, maybe it's your personality quirks, or maybe it's your mannerisms and the way you kind of talk. But kids just have a way of resembling their parents. For example, every time my daughter Lily looks up at me with her little eyes wanting a hug or a hand on the back, it just instantly makes me think of her mom. Because that's the way my wife is. That's how she receives love best from me. So that just goes to show that somewhere in there, it's a part of Lily's programming, my daughter, to be like her mom. In the same way, there are parts of being human that point distinctly to God's nature. And that's really what it means to be made in the image of God. That said, I believe there's even more to it than that, because Genesis 1 and 2 isn't just about humanity being something, it's about humanity doing something. So the truth from our passage today that we will return to throughout this sermon is that God created us to bear His image on the earth. And as far as our text is concerned, He did that in three ways. First, God made us to work. Ooh, yay, work. My favorite subject. Let's look back at chapter 2 for a second, hone in on verse 15 and verse 5. First with verse 5. It says, no shrub of the field yet had grown on the land, and no plant of the field had yet sprouted, for the Lord God had not made it rain on the land. And there was no man to work the ground. So this is our first clue that God intended for humans to work, because our text assumes that although Adam had not yet been formed yet, it was going to be Adam's job to work the ground. Then in verse 15 of chapter 2, Moses just comes right out and says it. The Lord God took the man and placed him in the Garden of Eden to work it and watch over it. Now, the timeless principle that we can learn from this is not that God created all of us to be gardeners and farmers. For one thing, some of y'all kill every plant you look at. I'm not even kidding. But we need to learn from this is that God created human beings to pursue jobs and tasks, and He hardwired us to draw a certain kind of fulfillment from them. Think about it. Why does a job well done feel so good? Why are we drawn to be so productive and do something useful with our time? Why are we so driven? We got to do something. Is it not because we bear the image of God? I think it is. And the evidence that supports that is right here in the creation account of Genesis. What do we see on days 1 through 6 of creation over and over again? We see God working until His job was complete, and then looking at His finished work and seeing that it was good. So working isn't just about something that we were created to enjoy, but it was also something that God Himself enjoyed. That said, we need to talk about what happened after the curse of sin entered the world, because I don't know if you noticed, but these days we live on a cursed earth. So the question is, how has that affected the way that we bear the image of God by working? Well, let's start to answer that question by taking a look at what God said when He laid out the consequences for Adam after the fall. Starting in Genesis 3:17 is what it says. The ground is cursed because of you. You will eat from it by means of painful labor all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. You will eat bread by the sweat of your brow until you return to the ground since you were taken from it, for you are dust, and you will return to dust. Ouch. So this is about, is this about easy work being good and hard work being bad? No, not at all. What we need to look at is the whole picture of what is being said here. And then we can discern three things about what has resulted from the curse of sin when it comes to work. Number one, it's painfully hard. Number two, it takes up more of our time than we want it to. And number three, instead of feeling fulfilled in our work, sometimes it feels meaningless. Now, something else has happened since the fall that has also changed everything. Jesus Christ came to die for our sins, and he rose from the grave to give us eternal life. And in him, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we are promised an abundant life full of meaning, full of purpose. So the reality is, the way we bear the image of God and how we work was marred by the curse of sin. But in some ways, it has also been restored by the cross of Christ. And while this full restoration still awaits the second coming, for now, we've been given the key to bearing the image of God in our work as New Testament believers in Colossians 3:23 through 24. Let's go ahead and read what this says starting in verse 23, and I'm willing to bet some of you have this one memorized. Paul writes, "Whatever you do, do it from the heart, as something done for the Lord and not for people, knowing that you will receive a reward of an inheritance from the Lord. You serve the Lord Christ." So listen, the truth is that because of the fall, sometimes work is painful, and there's nothing fun about it at all. We've all experienced that. But as believers, there is a way that we can work that helps us bear God's image, even through working in a place that's cursed. And it starts with our attitude. And that leads us into application today, which is this. No matter the job, give it all for God. At this point in life, I've gotten the privilege to go on, three different mission trips to Nicaragua, and I do want to remind you that we're getting ready to go on another one of those as a church in the month of August, so keep that in here. But every time I go down there, one of my favorite people to see is Eddie the bus driver. Now, if you've never been to Nicaragua, let me just tell you, driving a bus there is different from driving a bus here. Way, way different. Just picture the worst quality roads ever with no signs, no stoplights, and no speed limits. Crazy traffic, everybody honking. You don't know why. You sort of get the picture. But thank God for Eddie, because he drives that bus like a seasoned race car driver in a Porsche. Oh, man. It's not a glamorous job. It's not a job that is seen as highly important or significant, but Eddie gives his all for the glory of God. And his joy in his work is contagious, which ultimately shows other people the image of God. It draws them to God's character. The question is, what about you? Do you give your all for the glory of God when you work? Or does it depend on how you feel or whether or not your boss is around? Now, I realize the fact that some of you are retired and you don't have a job anymore. I also know that others of you are legitimately disabled. So what about you? And I've heard Bevan say, you know, the truth is that retired people work, you know, twice as hard. They have twice as much to do. So I'm looking forward to that. But what about you if you don't have, you know, what the world considers a career or a job, or you're finished with that? We just need to look back at the passage that we just read. It says, whatever you do, do your work for the glory of God. So it really extends beyond this, you know, what is the known idea as a job or career. I mean, my wife is a stay-at-home mom, and honestly, I think she works harder than just about anybody on this planet. So really, no matter where you may find yourself, I believe that God has a job for you, and he wants you to do it with your all, to give it your very, very best. But listen, this isn't just about how hard you work. This is also about who you're working for. And on that note, I got something to admit today. I like to please people. I like it when people tell me I'm doing a good job. And when people tell me I'm not, well, it's really, really hard for me not to take it way, way too hard. And church, I know I'm not the only one. But here's the truth I try to remember. The moment you please one person, you're disappointing another. That really is the truth. So why not do your work to please God instead? Because the reality is, if you want to bear the image of God to others and how you work, just remember, no matter the job, give it all for God. However, if all we do is work, we're missing the point, because the second way our text shows us that we were designed to be God's image bearers is this: God made us to rest. Let's go ahead and read chapter 2 again, starting with verse 1, and this time we'll end in verse 3. Moses writes, "So the heavens and the earth and everything in them were completed. On the seventh day, God had completed his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. God blessed the seventh day and declared it holy, for on it he rested from all the work of creation." Now, one thing to note about this passage is that really the meaning of the word holy is to be set apart from everything else. So God essentially said in verse 3 that there would be this special day of rest that was designed to be set apart from the other days of work. Beyond that, verse 3 also says that God blessed the seventh day. So what we need to realize is that this is really about more than just God resting. This is about God creating, promoting, and setting the example for a day of rest all at the same time. In fact, this day of rest was so important to God that he established it as one of the Ten Commandments. In Exodus 20, 8 through 11, God told Moses, "Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. You are to labor 6 days and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. You must not do any work. You, your son or daughter, your male or female servant, your livestock, or the resident alien who is within your gates." Okay, so everybody. Nobody's supposed to do any work. "For the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and everything in them in 6 days. Then he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the seventh day and declared it holy." So God actually commanded all of the Israelites to take a Sabbath day, and it was designed to give them rest. But somehow, some of y'all know the story, over time, they found a way to mess that up too. By the time Jesus entered the scene, the religious leaders had added an entire code of rules that made God's law of the Sabbath more of a tedious chore than a day of rest. And that's why Jesus spent so much time correcting them in the Gospels on the issue of the Sabbath. However, in Matthew 5:17, Jesus himself said he did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. So, as New Testament believers, something very important that we need to talk about today is how Jesus fulfilled the law of the Sabbath. And I think there's quite a bit of confusion about that in the church today. So I'm looking forward to touching on that. Because if we can figure it out, then we can get to the bottom of how we should view and apply the Sabbath rest ourselves today. That said, there are two ways in which Jesus fulfilled the law of the Sabbath. Number one, he clarified the purpose of the Sabbath. Number two, he is the Sabbath. One example of the fact that Jesus clarified the purpose of the Sabbath can be found in Mark 2, 23 through 28. Here's what it says, starting in verse 23. "On the Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields, and his disciples began to make their way, picking some heads of grain." Oh no, they're going to have it. It's coming to him, picking those heads of grain. "The Pharisees said to him, 'Look, why are you doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?' He said to them, 'Have you never read what David and those who were with him did when he was in need and hungry? How he entered the house of God in the time of Abiathar the high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for anybody to eat except for the priest, and also gave some of it to his companions. Then he told them, "The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. So then the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath.'" Now, what this passage shows us is that the Sabbath was never created to be a burden on us, but to give us rest. The Pharisees had become so obsessed with keeping people from working that they created more work for them. But Jesus helped the religious leaders see that the Sabbath wasn't designed to make us sweat under the shackles of legalism. It was designed to give us a break. So in doing that, Jesus clarified the purpose of the Sabbath. However, Christ did more than simply set the Pharisees straight. He also became the very thing that is our Sabbath rest. I don't have time to make the case today, but when you get some free time, be sure to check out Hebrews 4, 9 through 11, and make sure to pay attention to the context as well. In that passage, the Bible essentially says that Jesus is our Sabbath because he is our rest from the labor of constantly trying to be good enough to be acceptable to God through the law and various sacrifices. So in summary, Jesus fulfilled the law of the Sabbath because he clarified its original purpose and because he became the ultimate Sabbath rest for the people of God. Now, what that means for us is that we don't need to fear we're transgressing the law if we decide to lift a finger on Saturday. In fact, the New Testament is clear that Christ followers are free from the obligation of the Sabbath. Colossians 2, 16 through 17 says, "Therefore, don't let anyone judge you in regard to food or drink, or in the matter of a festival, or a new moon, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of what was to come. The substance is Christ." Galatians 4, 9 through 10 says, "But now that you know God, or rather are known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elements? Do you want to be enslaved to them all over again? You are observing special days," which would include the Sabbath, "months, seasons, and years." So church, you may not have realized this before, but the fact that Christians are not obligated to keep the Sabbath is a black and white issue in Scripture. That said, while the law of the Sabbath was fulfilled in Christ, the principle of the Sabbath rest transcends the law. God rested thousands of years before the stone tablets were ever given to Moses. In fact, the principle of rest is actually something Jesus encouraged and practiced himself. In Mark 6, 30 through 31, the disciples had just returned from being sent out to do miracles and preach the good news. And after they had finished telling Jesus about it, this is what he said to him. He said, "Come away by yourselves to a remote place and rest for a while." Notice the fact that he didn't say, "Toughen up," or "You can rest when you're dead." Jesus, he flat out told them that you should get some R&R, disciples. Like, take a breather. That's what he told them. And one of the reasons why is because Jesus practiced the rhythm of rest himself. In Luke 5:16, it says that Jesus often withdrew to deserted places and prayed. So the question we need to be asking is not so much whether or not we should keep the Sabbath day, but why God practiced rest and asked us to do the same. The answer is because we were created to bear the image of God. What I mean is, within every human being is the built-in, hardwired need to experience regular breaks from the ongoing demands of life. All of us grow tired and weary. Our brains quit working. Our bodies quit giving. Our souls quit going. So while we aren't required to keep the Sabbath as believers, it's still a very good idea to take a day of rest every week. And I'll give you two reasons why. Number one, taking a weekly day of rest will remind you that you're more than what you do. I try to take a day off every Friday, and I do my best to avoid thinking about, talking about, or worrying about anything related to my responsibilities as pastor. And one of the main reasons I do that is because I need to continually be reminded by God that I'm not just a pastor to him. I'm his child. The reality is that none of us are doing anything productive away from our relationship with Christ. So if you find that your worth is more wrapped up in the things that you accomplish than the person you've been made to be in Christ, then one day you're going to wake up and wonder why you wasted your life away. Number two, taking a day of rest will protect you from believing the lie that God can't handle things if you're not on the clock. If you always feel like you're too urgently needed to take a break, then odds are you aren't needing God urgently enough. Practicing regular periods of rest is an exercise in trust, because when we stop working, we're telling God that we trust him to provide more than we trust ourselves to provide. And the truth is that's the only thing that's going to work long term, because as one of my favorite authors, Lance Wood, says repeatedly in his book called Replenish, all of us have a bucket inside of us. And that bucket is full of everything God has given us to contribute to the world through our work. But the thing is, life has a way of coming along and putting holes in your bucket. Whether it be unrelenting stress, difficult conversations, injuries, or family issues, everybody's got some holes in their bucket. And church, the only way to patch those up is by setting aside a regular day that you can rest and get away from the craziness. So, if you want to bear God's image and how you rest, then just remember this: one day a week will patch your leak. One day a week will patch your leak. The reality is, when your bucket doesn't have a bunch of holes in it, you have more to give others, and that will enable you to point people to God's nature. That said, I want to take this a step further, because it's one thing to take a day off, and it's quite another to make that day restful. So today I want to give you an acrostic to help you remember what steps you can take to turn a day off into a day of rest, starting with letter R, recover well. If you've been getting up at 5 a.m. to go into work every day, then it might be counterproductive for you to get up at 4 on your one day off to go fishing. I'm preaching to myself on this. I mean, I understand it. Sometimes you just can't help yourself. I'm just saying, maybe if you're not getting enough sleep, you should try to get some sleep on your day of rest. In the same song, but a different verse, if your kids are wearing you out, then if you don't schedule some time away from them, you aren't going to rest either. So however you spend your day, you've got to rest in a way that separates you from whatever it is that, for lack of a better phrase, takes the life out of you. If you don't, it's not going to be very effective. Moving on to letter E, enjoy life. You have a hobby that puts your mind at ease? Is there something you like to do so much that it just puts a smile on your face every time, and you just tell God, thank you? Okay, I'll just go ahead and speak to the men for a second right now, because I know what you're thinking. Yes, God created your favorite activity too. And frankly, within the confines of a biblical marriage, I would say, go for it. But last time I checked, that isn't always going to be on the table, so I regret to inform you that you're going to have to find some other things to enjoy doing. But in all seriousness, if you don't have a hobby or something that you do for fun, then my advice is to please get one. Young families out there, this is for you, okay? Currently, I'm averaging 50 hours a week. I have a 3-year-old. I have a 6-year-old. I have a 1-year-old. I know how it can be. I know. But don't tell me you don't have time for fun, because the reality is you can't afford not to have time for fun. Talk to your spouse about this and get something worked out so that the two of you can have some time away to unwind. In my family, Caroline takes care of the kids Friday so I can get away, and I try to take care of the kids Saturday so she can get away. Now, sometimes it can't be a full day. Sometimes it can't always be the same, but for the most part, that's our pattern. It's a healthy one. Helps us stay sane. Helps us patch those leaks. So my advice is, when you take a day of rest, set aside some time to enjoy life. However, the reality is that if that's all you do on your day of rest, then you're going to wind up feeling empty and chaotic, because you'll only truly rest if you pay attention to letter S in the acrostic, which is to seek God. Seek God. When you're consumed with work and life, there aren't really very many adequate moments for you to listen into what God is saying, other than your quiet time, and in my experience, that's just not enough. So make sure to take the time on your day to rest and pause and create space for the Holy Spirit to work in your life. Because if you do, the peace of Christ will overcome you. The strength that you don't have for anything else, it'll fill you. That's the only thing that can really give you that, is seeking God, is giving him that space to speak in your life. Oftentimes on my day off, I process all kinds of things I couldn't process during the week about what God's doing in my life, simply because I can finally take a time to stop, reflect in prayer. That said, good luck with that if you neglect letter T, which is for tune out. These little devices right here will destroy your day of rest. Set up filters, put it on airplane mode, lock it away in your gun safe, I don't know. Whatever you have to do, get your smartphone away from you, because these little chaos machines And we'll do two things on your day off, and neither of them are good. Number one, smartphones will connect you with emails, texts, and calls that are related to work, which could at any time make a peaceful moment into a stressful one. And number two, smartphones provide us access to endless informational and social feeds, which studies have shown actually cause more fatigue than they do help us relax. So if you plan on actually resting, I seriously recommend you distance yourself from your phone in whatever way you deem necessary. That said, maybe there are some other things in your life that you also need to take a break from. I don't know what it might be for you, but the rule is if something is a distraction that pulls you back into that stress and causes you to feel like you need to do something right now, silence it on your day of rest. So there are four easy steps that you can take to turn your day off into a day of rest. Recover well, enjoy life, seek God, and tune out. Now, the third way we can bear the image of God that is revealed in our passage is the fact that God made us to rule. Rule. I'm aware of the fact that in the 21st century, the word rule doesn't exactly fit with modern ideologies. However, it's nonetheless a very biblical idea when it comes to the relationship between humanity and the earth. Let's look back at our passage one more time, and specifically at verses 26 and 28 of chapter 1. For verse 26, it says, "They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock, the whole earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth." Then in verse 28, it says, "God blessed them, and God said to them, 'Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and every creature that crawls on the earth.'" Now, there are two things I want to point out about what we just read. Number one, rule and subdue in the Hebrew mean to rule and subdue. Number two, God placed the entire earth under our authority, from animals to natural resources. So this is yet another way that we were created to bear the image of God, because if there is one thing that is a part of God's nature, it's authority. That said, the authority that God gave us in creation was never designed to supersede his own. In Genesis 1, 26 and 28, God decided that we were designed to rule the earth. But in Genesis 2, 17 through 18, God gave Adam and Eve parameters for that rule. He told them not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So from the very beginning, God established we were never created to rule without first being under his rule. However, the one parameter that God gave to Adam and Eve, they disobeyed it. And so really, if you think about it, the very first sin was actually just a failure to understand. We can't rule the earth if we don't let God first rule us. And honestly, ever since then, humanity has always struggled with seeing ruling as a way to build selfish pride and instead of carrying out divine responsibility and privilege. But once again, Jesus came to set the record straight about authority in the kingdom of God. However, before we dive into the teachings of Christ, we need to talk about the difference between leadership and stewardship, because both have to do with authority. The bottom line is that leadership is about people, and stewardship is about possessions. So when it comes to the issue of ruling the earth, it's actually a matter of stewardship. And thankfully, Jesus had a lot to say on that subject. But for now, let's just take a look at one example in Luke 12, starting with verse 48. Starting with verse 42, we're going to finish verse 48. The Lord said, "Who then is the faithful and sensible manager? His master will put in charge of his household servants to give them their allotted food at the proper time. Blessed is that servant whom the master finds doing his job when he comes. Truly, I tell you, he will be put in charge of all his possessions. But if that servant says in his heart, 'My master is delaying in his coming,' and starts to beat the male and female servants and eat and drink and get drunk, that servant's master will come on a day he does not expect, on an hour he does not know, and he will cut him to pieces," meek and mild Jesus, "cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the unfaithful. And that servant who knew his master's will and didn't prepare himself to do it will be severely beaten, but the one who did not know and did what deserved punishment will receive a light beating. From everyone who has been given much," here's the point, "much will be required. And from the one who has been entrusted with much, even more will be expected." Now, there's a lot in this parable, and it's definitely not just about stewardship. But one thing we can learn from Luke 12, 42 through 48 is that when God places something under our authority, he does expect that we'll take care of it to the best of our ability. That said, there's a balance in this. Because when God gives us something to steward, that thing should never become what stewards us either. For example, if God has given you a lot of money, you should do what you can to make the most of it. But there's a point when you cross a line and do obsession and idolatry and your money starts taking charge of you. So for application, when it comes to our authority and stewardship over the earth, just remember it this way. Rule the earth well, but don't let the earth rule you. Now, one way that you can put that into practice is to hunt ethically. Conservational studies have shown that hunting actually keeps animals from being wiped out from overpopulation, which breeds deadly diseases. Now, obviously, if everybody decided to go shoot a deer a day, that would also wipe out a population. But as it is, the state has set up such short seasons that would never become close to becoming a reality. Honestly, I think the seasons could be a whole lot longer and less restrictive, but that's besides the point. The point is, don't be afraid to get out there and hunt, because it's a good way to feed your family and rule the earth well. That said, try not to be an idiot about it either. It's probably not the best stewardship practice to throw explosives in a pond or carelessly shoot an animal in a bad spot for no good reason. Don't do that. Just because you've got the freedom to do something doesn't mean that you always should. It's the same thing with litter. If a straw wrapper accidentally blows out of your car while you are driving, you do not need to break down into tears and feel like you're a bad steward of the earth. Okay? But at the same time, don't go dropping off a bag of trash in the woods for somebody else to have to deal with either. There's a balance. Common sense. Resources and animals were put here for us. We weren't put here for them. That's what the Bible says. But that said, we should be responsible stewards given the fact that God put everything under our care. Remember, rule the earth well, but don't let the earth rule you. So in summary, before the fall, God created us to bear his image on the earth by working, by resting, and by ruling in a way that points back to how he works, how he rests, and how he rules. When it comes to work, no matter the job, give it all for God. When it comes to rest, one day a week will patch your leak. And when it comes to ruling, rule the earth well, but don't let the earth rule you. Now, I realize there was a lot of information today, but if you're not a believer and you're here and you're wondering what in the world to do with what you just heard, let me just say this. I do believe there's a beauty inside all of us that points to God, whether you're a Christian or not. But the thing is, if you don't know Jesus, then your sin is going to eternally separate you from a God who loves you. And I don't want that to happen. I want to do everything I can and say everything I can to keep that from happening today. So, there's only one way that God has given for you to come to know him, and that is to believe in his son, Jesus Christ. We've talked about today how the curse of sin has affected so many things negatively, but I don't want anyone to just experience the curse of sin without the healing and the restoration of what Jesus did. So that's, if that's you today, then hear this. Jesus is the way. He is the way. He is the life. He is the healing from the curse. He's the way to have an abundant life. There's nothing greater than him. Let's pray. Lord, I do pray for anyone who's here that doesn't know you, Lord, that they would hear your voice through all of this, that they would hear you calling in their heart and their spirit. Lord, there's something inside all of us that longs for the eternal, that longs for something more than this cursed earth. Lord, help the person who doesn't know you to see today that you are that thing that we seek for and can't and don't have. That you are the one that fills those gaps. That you are the one, you are the answer. That believing in what you did on the cross and how you rose again, that you are God, that you sacrifice yourself for our sin, that you are the payment, that you are the answer. Lord, that they would see that and believe. And Lord, for us here today who do know you, who have made a decision to believe in that, to believe in you, God, help us to remember that we are to bear your image here on the earth. Help us to remember what you said while you were here that corrected some of our wrong ways of thinking about work and rest and ruling. And help us to put these things into practice throughout the week. In Jesus' name, amen.
And so